653, the wolves that have crossed the river are howling.
Just off the Park Road in Yellowstone's Lamar Valley, wolves from the Junction Butte Pack have made a kill.
Yeah, go ahead, feel free to take a look through there. That's the Junction Butte Pack.
It's early morning in the end of August, the time when wolves increasingly go after bison. Wolf technician Jeremy Sundaraj is on the scene watching the pack feed.
So what we're trying to do here is just kind of count how many there are, record their behavior, if we can see like what the carcass is. This is almost certainly a kill just based on how they're behaving around it. It seems like we just missed it by a few minutes here.
Sundaraj is 29 years old and hopes to start work on his doctorate in biology at the University of Montana. He's been a watcher of wolves since his family visited Yellowstone when he was just a boy.
And if we're quiet, we can actually maybe hear him howling.
Lately, he's turned his attention to listening to them. Known for their landmark 30-year wolf study, Yellowstone's biologists have counted and tagged and tracked wolves since they were reintroduced here in 1995. It was a controversial and politically charged move. Now, they use airplanes to spot them, helicopters to track them, and dart guns to tag them so they can be fitted with radio and GPS collars. And with advances in artificial intelligence, there's a new way to study wolves using sound.
Not only can we hear them here and record their howling 24/7, 365 days a year, but we often can link behaviors of wolves by observing them when they are vocalizing. What is the cause and effect of howling? Then we can look at data from GPS collars with them moving around the landscape. How do they move in response to vocalizations?
Dan Staler is the senior wildlife biologist for Yellowstone National Park, a job that includes plenty of legwork, like replacing the batteries and gathering the data from this sound recorder hidden in a tree near park headquarters.
One more, Jeremy.
Yellowstone's 9 wolf packs are spread across the park, with the majority located in the northern range. More than 100 wolves live in these packs, and Staler's team has been recording their barks, yips, and howls for the past year.
That's another goal of ours, is can we detect unique pack signatures and use that?
He says they've collected over 7,000 wolf sounds and have been able to identify the acoustic signatures of several wolf packs in the park. In the future, Staler thinks this bioacoustic work could partially replace the hazardous duty of capturing and collaring wolves.
So what I could envision down the road a decade from now is that we may not have to collar certain packs or put collars out in certain areas of the park. And then with new cutting edge AI tools, we hope, we're not sure yet, but we hope we can answer really interesting questions about what are wolves actually saying, or can we count wolves? Can we identify unique individuals?
Here in Montana's Tom Miner Basin, just a few miles up the road from Yellowstone, there's a team of researchers working on these cutting-edge new tools, combining video cameras, sound recorders, and artificial intelligence in one device.
Yeah, we're just gonna go to the back of this valley. There's a group of trees back here that's kind of a special spot.
Cody Goldhahn is a fifth-generation Montana rancher who helped invent what's called the Grizz Cam.
This is where we're going to set up the Grizz Cam. Get a lot of animals through here. It's super easy, so we're just going to put it on this stake. It's just a one-step process to deploy it. We can actually log into it with any phone or computer, and then it fires this thing up and goes ahead and starts recording us. And then it'll do its test run, and then it's going to wait for the next wild thing to walk by. We've had grizzly bears come through and bite it. We've had black bears pull this out and take it off and stash it somewhere else. So we couldn't ask for a better spot with testing here.
That's where linguistics researcher Dr. Jeff Reed comes in. Reed had been experimenting with AI to study wolves near his home in the Paradise Valley. He agreed to lend his technical expertise to the project.
This is a wolf chorus howl, and we're using AI from Google to see if we can count the number of wolves in a chorus howl. So this is a group of wolves. It's like you walking into a bar and all the people are talking, and you can pick out a particular person in the room. Wolves can pick out other wolves that they know in this cacophony of sound.
The key to the technology is pattern recognition, according to Reed. These colorful patterns are what's called a spectrogram of wolf howls, representing their strength and frequency over time. Artificial intelligence, he says, can pick out the patterns and identify individual wolves much faster than any human could.
And so by putting a tiny recorder on an individual wolf, we can study them over time and figure out how their voices might change over even time, but how they're identifying one another on the landscape.
This looks like a trail cam that's very technically advanced, but you're saying that some of these sensors actually have AI functionality.
Yes.
And that's something that's not very common.
But the technology doesn't stop there. Its inventors say the Grizz Cam is able to listen to human conversations from hundreds of yards away, pinpoint gunshot locations, even identify the make and model of vehicles through sound.
And I see all of the events from all of the cameras. I can select just a particular camera and see what's going on there. I can find keywords like skull, click on the keyword and see the image that has the skull in it. That's an elk skull.
GrizzCam can send notifications to computers and cell phones when a specific animal or person is detected, making the GrizzCam ideal for monitoring large landscapes like resorts, ranches, or national parks. Here in Dallas, Texas, there's a company paying for a couple dozen GrizzCams to be placed in Yellowstone. Colossal Biosciences is a genetic engineering business that has made recent news by taking DNA from extinct animals and bringing them back to life. Colossal recently made news for claiming they brought back a species of wolf that died out after the Ice Age. Next, they want to bring back something close to the woolly mammoth. Can these controversial animals help bring attention to other threatened species worldwide?
Colossal's a moonshot company, right? We, in everything we do, we aim as high as possible. And I think for me, the moonshot with bioacoustics and wolves is that, can we reduce the conflict between wolves and humans? And can we anthropomorphize the wolves and help explain that these are empathetic, emotionally complex animals?
Colossal is donating 25 Grizz cams to Yellowstone National Park to be installed in a grid system throughout the landscape. They're also funding more than $100,000 for research connected to Yellowstone's bioacoustic study.
We're really hopeful then that they can collect tons and tons of data that our team can then begin to distill and train the AI to move on from just classifying wolf calls to classifying individual calls.
But just how much of the public domain is being recorded by this new technology? And what about privacy concerns when it comes to sound and video recorders in wild places like Yellowstone? Here at the University of Montana, Professor Christopher Preston studies the ethics of human interactions with the natural world and how technology can shape those interactions.
I mean, if you ask me, would I rather a wolf gets darted from a helicopter and have a radio collar put on it, or a wolf gets listened to by a 24/7 recording device? It's pretty clear to me that I'd rather have the wolf be listened to by the recording device, because that's a non-invasive technique.
Preston says in this case, it's pretty clear that using artificial intelligence to monitor wolves in Yellowstone poses very few ethical concerns. But take that technology and use it to monitor humans, and he's got questions.
With a technology that clearly can gather information about the biological world and the human world at the same time, I would want to know how those distinctions are being made, because we do have a different sort of ethic for the human world to the one that we have for the wild world.
You know, it strikes me that if I plan a backpacking trip out into the Rocky Mountains, Montana, and in 20 years, if there's 100 cameras out there placed by the Forest Service or the national parks, and they can tell exactly where I went in, what I did, where I camped, if I caught a fish in a lake, and where I went out, the landscape doesn't seem so wild anymore.
No, I share that concern. I share the concern that you go into landscapes like that to not be part of a system where people are looking at you, where people know what you're doing. You go there to use the cliche to get away from it all. And you're certainly not getting away from it all if there is the potential for your movements to go into a database somewhere.
So the technology can blur out faces. It can remove audio of humans talking so that they can study wildlife and not infringe upon people's privacy.
GrizzCam's Jeff Reed says he's committed to keeping the technology in his company's devices from being used in ways he doesn't intend it to. And that includes his promise not to sell any public data it collects. He said other companies developing this technology might not have those safeguards, and the technology is rapidly expanding.
This stuff is coming, whether it's in 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, the world. I mourn at the fact that satellites can now get to resolution and know where I'm walking in Yellowstone. It's over. It's gone. The world is getting smaller. But just because the world's getting smaller doesn't mean that that 6% of the wild world that's still there isn't there, right? We may know a lot about it, but the big question is, do we still want it around?
For Dan Staler, that big question is at the core of his research. Just exactly how do wild creatures like wolves affect the landscape of America's first national park? And why should humans want to watch and listen to them?
I think big picture, we're really more interested in understanding the community ecology of Yellowstone. So not just being laser focused on wolves, but what does the world of wolf mean to the life of a cougar, to a grizzly bear, to the scavenger guild, to the vegetation communities, to all the diverse prey that wolves are up, interact with here in the landscape. So I think, you know, we're gonna keep this study going. There'll be new emerging questions, but the fundamental question will be, why is Yellowstone's wildlife community important to this landscape, important to Montana, and important to the world?
For Impact, I'm Matt Standal.